Thanks, Ben, and good morning, everyone. You know, if we think about what's happened with wireless over the last 10 years, it's really gone through a pretty radical change. I mean, looking back 10 years, you know, the phone really was just a phone. It mostly did voice. Voice, we always said, was the killer app, and data was definitely around. You know, we launched a phone called the PDQ, which was a Palm smartphone about 13 years ago. Really didn't do too well. So, you know, it was around, but it really hadn't impacted our lives the way that it does today. And, you know, it's really the innovation that's happened out of the industry, new technologies that have come out, new advances in user interface and usability that have really made the difference. And so, you know, it's changed this experience that everybody expects of the internet. They really expect to have access to their data anywhere and anytime. And the phone, much more than being seen as a device that you talk on, now is a device that you compute with. And, you know, as we look at how that happened, it really was efforts that were put in over the last 10 years to put consumer electronics and computing functionality into the phone. And with the amount of research and development that's gone in, you know, we really exceed now with many of the features that are in the phone some of the functionality of dedicated consumer electronics devices. And so now we see people using their phones as replacements for or complements to their existing consumer electronics devices. And we're seeing new consumer electronic device categories emerge, you know, things like e-readers, and obviously there's a lot of focus on tablets here. And we saw the stats on the video before in terms of the number of new networks that are rolling out and the kind of demand for data that's being created by having all of these devices, all this functionality. So kind of what does it mean? I mean, how does this impact things going forward? And really what we believe is going forward, sort of everything is going to be connected. And when people talk about the Internet of Things, we talk about the Internet of Everything. And really what that means is that around you in the environment, there's going to be hundreds or thousands of things that are actually networked and able to be addressed. And a really key point, and I think a key vision for the industry going forward, is that the phone will sit in the center of this web of all these things around you and sort of orchestrate your interactions with the things in the physical environment around you, with digital things that are associated with you, with people, with places. All these kinds of things will be orchestrated by the phone. And you have very real-time access to all sorts of information, whether it's the people that you meet or the places that you go, or the services that are available, the content that's available when you get somewhere. So how's this going to happen? I mean, there's really kind of three key things I'm going to focus on, say how will this happen. We believe that peer-to-peer is going to be a critical component here. We think that you're really going to have these devices have to support multiple radios, not just one radio, and the devices are going to continue to expand in capabilities. So maybe we're just to kind of look into that a little bit more in depth. And, you know, we're really dealing with a very complex environment. You know, more and more of these devices are going to have connectivity. And the key there is, if we're going to interact with these devices, it better be simple. Because if it's hard, like pairing up your Bluetooth device or connecting to some networks, you know, that's going to be too much of a barrier. And so, you know, we have all this stuff around us. We have a wide range of devices, whether it's phones or PCs or TVs, stereo equipment, cameras, tablets, you know, picture frames, you know, all of this kind of stuff. They're all going to work on different sorts of hardware platforms. They're going to run different sorts of software operating systems. And adding to that complexity, we're going to have different radios, not just the cellular radio, but all the local area and personal area radios and satellite and GPS, and now NFC is getting a lot of attraction now. And some of the stuff, by the way, is not going to just be wireless. It's going to be wired as well. And so like I said, we're going to need to make all these things connect very seamlessly in a simple way and very securely. So if we dive into some of these issues that I talked about, okay, so peer-to-peer. One of the things that we think is going to be important is sort of this notion of proximity-based peer-to-peer, where you really can go around with your device and discover the things in the environment that are around you. And so you'll enter a room or you'll go to somewhere, and if there's services running, your phone will detect it, and it needs to detect it with very low power. So it needs to be done possibly even at the physical layer of the device so that we can find out what's around us. You need to authenticate so you know when you're talking to something. Say the thing you're talking to is a cash register to check out. You want to know you're talking to the right thing. Or if it's downloading content, the content provider wants to know that you're authorized to get that information. And you know that you're going to want to be able to really connect between these devices with this peer-to-peer and not necessarily have to go out and load the network, which is already, load the cellular network, it's already so heavily loaded with traffic today. So we have a couple of technologies that we're showing off at our booth. We have a technology called FlashLink, which does this advertising of services at a very low level in the physical stack, so that at very low power you can find out as you wander through the world and see, hundreds or thousands of things that are around you that you might want to interact with. It's a TDDO FDMA system, and it's synchronized, and it runs in its own licensed spectrum. So this is a question. I mean, is there going to arrive enough applications to drive this kind of technology into the market? So we're looking at we're making those kinds of investments in R&D. The other thing that we're looking at is completely on the other side, which is a technology called AllJoin, which is basically a software way of doing a similar thing. It's not quite as efficient from a battery standpoint, but it uses the existing technologies like Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and allows you to interact. And we'll get started with this idea of proximity-based discovery by using this kind of technology, and we'll see that roll out in different handsets in the coming year. So that's, if we look at the peer-to-peer, that's kind of what we're thinking about on the peer-to-peer side. It's also now we have this issue of the multiple radios, and so we're already seeing this, right? I mean, how many radios do you have in a handset today? It's not just the cellular radios of all the different Gs. You got Bluetooth and GPS and Wi-Fi now increasingly going into the devices and so forth. The other thing is, as we talk here about things like LTE, there's an awful lot of bands that we've got to support as well. And so choosing which bands need to be supported are going to be quite difficult as well. And we're going to see all of this kind of stuff get embedded into CE devices as well. Now, maybe some of the CE devices will have fewer bands, and you'll have to figure out which band it is that you talk to the devices that are around you on, and so forth. And so all of this stuff's going to need to be coordinated. And the other thing that we're going to need to do is we're going to need to deal with just the explosion of data on the networks around us. And we have a bunch of different technologies. Obviously, we're driving the wireless technologies hard to cause that to happen, but we're looking at other ways of using things like unpaired spectrum or making the network run much more efficiently. So if we look at some of these particular use cases, so the connected home, I mean, clearly there's a lot of stuff in the house that you're going to want to be able to talk to. You want to be able to use the displays that are on the wall and the speakers that are in your stereo system. And, if you just go to we were just at CES show, for example, and the head of the CEA said they're projecting 70% of consumer electronics devices are going to be connected to the internet by 2014. So clearly Wi-Fi is going to be a key component of it. It allows the data offloading from the cellular networks, and that's great. But, I think that we're also going to see different kinds of networking technologies, whether it's wired or wireless, in the home. And we made an acquisition in terms of getting access to sell into things like putting these technologies into TVs or printers or access points or all these kinds of devices. So we're really focused on this notion of enabling the connected home. We also think with the connected home, there's the opportunity to take your content with you, stream it from the store that's in your house. When you go over to your friend's house, you'll be able to bring it to your friend's house with you, and the phone's going to be the key to authenticating and causing that information to flow with you. The other thing that we think is interesting about connected home is this notion, and connected car as well, is this notion that you'll bring these devices with you. You want them to connect wirelessly, but we still have one wire, which is the power cord. And so we're working very hard on making charging be done wirelessly as well. So you just put your device down and it charges. You put it into the car, it charges, it also connects up. So we made some announcements there, and we're really working hard on that technology as well, trying to put together a consortium. And there's a lot of interest around wireless power right now. Another area that we think that there's clearly an opportunity is healthcare. And we're talking about consumer electronics, so why are we talking about healthcare? And if you talk to the industry, the healthcare industry, they recognize that healthcare needs to become much, much more personal. So it's really going to be much more of a consumer-driven industry going forward. And the other thing is that we want to leverage the scale of the consumer electronics industry and the techniques of the consumer electronics industry to drive the cost down, and that's particularly important in emerging markets. But I do think that as we look forward into the future, as today, when we have our phone, we feel like we're connected to our friends and family and colleagues, even when we're not directly talking to them, because you know that you could talk to them. I think the same thing will come true in the next 5 to 10 years, where you will feel connected to your healthcare professional because you're wearing body-worn sensors or there's sensors in the environment around you. The phone is collecting this information. It's analyzing it. It's connecting to a call center, a monitoring center when something needs to happen. So you'll have the sense that you're being being looked after. And there's true economic incentive to get this done. There's chronic diseases account for almost 3/4 of the spending in healthcare, and chronic diseases can be managed much better by keeping track of how the person is taking care of themselves, making sure they're complying with treatment regimens and so forth. So really a tremendous opportunity there. And there's really a couple of ways. You know, the phone can act as a hub of wireless sensors that are around you. We can embed wireless into the medical devices themselves. So we're seeing glucometers and body fit devices is one of the things that's shown up here. It's going to have integrated 3G in it. It might have a home hub where your different devices talk over some radio technology and then get backhauled over the wireless technology into the network. So very interesting kinds of things. And then if we look at sort of what's enabling all of this stuff, you know, there's just more and more capabilities going into the devices. So we've been spending a lot of effort driving computing capability into the devices. We made a lot of announcements this week in terms of single core, dual core, quad core, the kinds of things that we can do with very low power to give very, very high compute performance to the device that you carry around in your hand. And so it's not just computing in terms of microprocessor, but it's also graphics performance, so you get those beautiful user interfaces that everybody wants. So we just see the tremendous opportunity in wireless to drive compute, graphics, all this kind of technology. And clearly, this means that the chips that go into the smartphones are going to go into the computing devices. We heard Microsoft talk about porting Windows onto the ARM platform. That's going to open up a lot of opportunity for the wireless industry to work and impact the computing industry. So finally, the last thing that I wanted to focus on was just how is the user interface going to work? I mean, if we're going to talk to all these consumer electronics devices around us, some of them don't have user interfaces that are very easy to have access to, and we think that's going to get done through a technology called augmented reality. What augmented reality does is it puts graphical objects, 3D graphical objects, into the view of your camera on your phone. It does it by using sensors in the phone. It also does it by using image recognition that the phone does, so a lot of processing is being done in the phone to do this. A lot of graphics is being done to make sure that that 3D object looks like it is staying in place in the real world when you look at it through the phone. And so you can imagine I can point to a picture frame on the wall and the phone will recognize it and pop out a little user interface and allow me to drag and drop my pictures onto that picture frame. Or I might be able to talk to this microphone or the display or things like that. And so we think that augmented reality will be a very, very interesting way to give a user interface to the real world, in addition to all the other things that we've been doing with it. We had a developer challenge. We got a lot of interesting games and so forth where you really put 3D technology into the real world. I think this is a very, very interesting opportunity. So to close, I would just say, you know, we're really in the beginning of this journey where all the things around us are going to be connected, and the phone is going to have that role in the center to sort of be your remote control of the things that are around you, or your sixth sense to detect what's around you. And I feel like this is just a very exciting time, sort of like the beginning of the mobile internet. You know, the same kind of excitement, the same kind of incentives to the developer community to drive innovation and also to the manufacturers and operators and everybody that's in the wireless industry. So I'm looking forward to that opportunity to do that together, and thanks very much.